Thunder Grunt.
How shall I do it?
Oh, I know.
I'll turn him into a flea.
A homeless?
Little flea.
And then I'll put the flea in a box.
And then I'll put that box inside of another box.
And then I'll mail that box to myself.
And when it arrives...
I'll smash it with a hammer.
It's brilliant.
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 I tell you...
Genius.
I say...
Oh!
His save on postage.
I'll just poison him with this.
In a small little ship in the center of Mars was a sack of souls with experiment scars. When a psychedelic monk said, I'll take two, and he put them in a rocket and he ate a lot of glue. And he shot them to Earth, and they turned into babies. They were named from that, and they rarely got rabies. And the monk made a movie of their whole entire lives. They were panoramic scenes and zooms of the thigh. And one time Bob had sex with a ladle, and one time Matt lost a vet to a cradle, and another time Bob caught a dinosaur mom, and another time Matt bought a replica of Guam. And all this more is on a DVD set, only $20.99 with the purchase of a gem. But if you call right now and say, where's my whisk? We'll include this
bonus disc.
Hey, welcome to Bonus Disc! I'm one of your hosts, Bob Rose, and with me is another host, Matt PA.
Hello.
And with us is returning guest of the show, Mike Ridgway.
Bonjour.
And Mike, you're here, so that means we watched an Andy Sidaris movie.
Master of the craft.
You did this to yourself,
which is
great.
These get better and better. These are just getting better and better. This one is so fucking crazy. I kind of love it.
Well, so wait, what have we watched so far? We watched Malibu Express.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Picasso Trigger.
Yep.
And there's one more, isn't there?
I mean, there was the one that Mondo did, but I don't think I think we've only watched two.
Have we only done two?
Yeah,
because you bought us a 12-pack.
Mm-hmm. I was trying to remember the other
day. Quarter of the way through, baby. That was number three.
We did it. We're a quarter.
I forget why I bought you the box of
because we all were at a live screening of Hard Ticket to Hawaii, and you said if I buy this box set of all 12 existing Andy Sidaris movies. Will you guys do it on bonus disc? And I said, yes, we'll do right in a row. But then we did Air Bud, all 14 Air Bud movies. And I was like, Mike, we're not doing that ever again.
Cannot watch the same director 14 times in a row ever again.
Ever.
Never again.
So then it became whenever you come on,
That's right.
We do Andy Sidaris movies. Right. So then this time we watched
Day of the Warrior.
Lethal Ladies.
Part of the Lethal Ladies series.
Right.
Day of the Warriors.
Lethal with
an LLU.
What it stands for something.
Legion of Enforcing Total Harmony and Law.
And Law.
Or maybe, is it Legion or Ladies?
I think it's Legion.
It's Legion.
It was Legion.
Yeah.
Because there's guys in it.
That's okay.
In the movie.
And, it's good for them to open it up to men, too.
It says all that and Law Ladies.
No.
It's lethal, the acronym,
and then Ladies.
That's what I'm saying, but if you said them all, like you said it out, like the whole thing, and then said Ladies after it.
So Legion Law of Ladies. Enforcing Total Harmony and Law Ladies.
Yeah, they're the Ladies
God,
of Lethal.
That sounds so bad.
They're the Ladies of Lethal.
Sure. And this is kind of the-
Bob!
Yes.
Bob!
Look.
What are you talking
it's
about?
It's the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Of fucking
yes, exactly. People are buying this
Agents
movie
of
because
of fucking,
there's a there's four these lethal ladies are topless the whole movie. This is why the movie is bought. You know what I mean?
Right.
That's why it's Lethal Ladies.
Well, they're not only buying movies; they are apparently buying books.
Oh, for God's sake!
So there's a little bonus extra on the
it's
DVD.
It's an Easter egg, technically.
Yeah.
Highlight the woman's thigh
on every disc.
And this time there is a little interview with Andy Sidaris and what was the
Julie Strain?
Julie Strain, thank you. I wanted to say Julia Stiles, and I was like, nope, that's not it.
Big difference.
Yes,
yeah.
Very big difference. And they're promoting his new book, which was some
Guns, Boobs, and Babes or something like that.
Yeah,
which is kind of the name.
Bombs, something like
it had
that.
Guns and boobs in it, or bombs in it, or something. Yeah. But he was promoting a book that he wrote about his film career,
mm-hmm.
which is amazing. by the way.
I'm really tempted to buy
it. So it's an autobiographical book with pictures that a man wrote
about
about his own filmography. It's not a retrospective by another fan.
But you can get a signed copy by Julie Strain.
Only $25 on
eBay.
Why
isn't he signing it? He wrote it. It's about him.
He's dead.
Oh. Well, it didn't come. But we're watching him shill it right there.
I mean, there has to be a limited amount of signed copies.
There's also
a limited amount of those things printed for a myriad of reasons. The fact that they're not going to get bought. He didn't have enough money to make that many of them. Well, a lot of reasons.
That was
not
in 96, right? Like, this was...
Yeah.
This was probably 96.
He could have signed every single copy that was ever printed in that book, to be honest.
Well, it might have been later, because the last movie on the box set is from 98. So they might have just filmed... They put together this box set maybe like after that last movie.
I mean, this box set is technically out of date, like I told you. They're starting to release these things as like collector's Blu-rays now.
The Andy Sidaris fans are clamoring
for it. Yeah, no, seriously, they are. Like,
I mean, these movies are bad.
They're
shit
nuts.
Insane.
Yeah, they're nuts. Yeah. So this...
What did you say? It's like the Frank Reynolds, like,
movie. It's Frank Reynolds. Andy Sidaris looks like Frank Reynolds, number one.
Yeah, he does.
I mean, and if you watch the Lethal Weapon episodes of It's Always Sunny, it would be these movies, except he would be in them.
Yeah.
That's the only difference.
That's
it wouldn't
what I'm
be
really
a big,
surprised
sexy
about.
Man. It would be him.
It would be him.
Yeah. I'm really surprised that there isn't a movie we've seen so far where Andy Sidaris gives himself a sex scene.
I think he knew better. Like, back then, he knew there was a creep factor here.
I don't even think it was that. He was like, these movies need to sell to people.
That too. Yeah.
To both men and women that want to fuck all the people I put in my movies.
Everyone needs to look like a porn star. Yeah. I do not look like a porn star.
Yeah. Fair enough.
He probably got sex off camera that he didn't need to talk about.
He's incompetent.
Yeah.
He's not an
idiot. He's satisfied in his own life. I see what you're saying now.
Yeah. I mean... Back then, the market for these things was huge.
Yeah.
So,
Yeah,
like the straight-to-video shit. So he knew that he needed everyone to look like a porn star that was about to attend a wrestling match. And then,
which is perfect for this because it stars Buff Bagwell, who like looks like a porn star who was a professional wrestler.
Right.
He was a terrible wrestler. He just looked like a sexy dude. He kind of, really big.
In my opinion, he looks like if George Michael took the Captain America serum.
Okay, yeah.
That's what he looks like to me.
I'll give you that.
Tell me he doesn't look like
that. And then put a headdress on.
Oh,
we'll get to it.
We'll get to that. Yeah. All right. How does this movie start? I'm glad you took some notes, Mike.
It starts with the Gimp Mask striptease.
Yes.
Right. And that's the credit. The opening credits is Cobra.
Cobra, damn it.
It's Julie K. Smith. She's famous. She's been in a lot of
movies. No, that's not Cobra. That's
not Cobra? That's the other woman?
I think it is. I think it's the Kim?
The movie doesn't actually answer that question.
No, it's not Kim.
God, we're already...
Yeah, I know. It's definitely not Kim. She says her name, and it was either Cobra or Scorpion.
No, no. When she takes off...
Maybe it is Cobra.
I know what Julie K. Smith looks like.
All right, fine.
That was her. Okay, it was Cobra. That was Cobra.
There are two blonde, very busty women that look almost identical in this movie. So
it's like it's you hard write to a tell script, and you're like, what's everybody's name? Let me watch American Gladiators and just
Cobra.
You know what I mean? I'm surprised no one was named like Laser and shit, you know?
Dude.
But she's up on a stage doing a striptease, and
she's
got a gimp mask on
for no reason,
and her shirt has holes for her breasts.
Yeah, so she unzips her the coverings for her boobs. Her boobs pop out. She starts shaking those around while she's wearing the gimp mask. And then at the end, she takes off the gimp mask, and she's just like, ah.
Right. And that's when she says her name. She's like, if you want to.
She looks into the camera.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, she's like, if you want to own me, you can. My name's Cobra.
Yeah.
And I was like, what are we watching right now? I mean, I thought it was like an ad for
softcore porn. That's
what
we're
watching. She looks directly into the camera. It's awkward.
This movie was more softcore porn than any of the ones we've watched.
Agreed.
Like, there's, so far.
Oh, yeah. I mean,
easily.
Yeah, there's that whole part. Yeah.
This was a Cinemax movie more than the other ones.
Yeah.
This had less helicopters and more tits.
Oh, fuck. I forgot to pay attention to who wrote, the original music. Who wrote, the score for this.
That's probably the same for every movie.
I mean, I bet he had a great time.
Yeah.
So after that, we are taken to the computer section at Lethal Headquarters.
Which you'll know because there's a giant sign on the door that says computer section.
And you would also know because the woman typing on the computer looks like a porn star.
Yeah.
And is like,
she's got extremely large breasts and she's wearing her
barely covered breasts.
I don't want to talk about what women look like, but we can't talk about these movies without...
She's in
everyone
like,
looks like insane.
Yes.
They look insane.
Their outfits are outrageous. Their shit, you're like, who? No one dresses like that ever.
They all look like we watched Picasso Trigger. They look like fucking video game characters.
Yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Giant sex organs. Like, yeah. That's what they look like.
It's like the character creator and slid the sex organ bar up.
We need people to know that these are women, like, so just make the breasts.
It's the scene from Weird Science. With
what
the
if
breasts?
Andy Sidaris is just like so like fog vision, like everything looks like a blur to him, so he needs like very exaggerated body shapes.
Otherwise, I can't see boobs unless they're triple E or above.
Everybody else just looks like a shape.
All the guys need to look like they can't fit in clothes like a human.
Yes. Well, they don't fit in clothes. They don't. All their clothes are unbuttoned at the top.
Like we talked about. I love muscular guys or porn star dudes who wear suits. I think that's the funniest shit. I don't know why. Because they look like they're so uncomfortable.
Yeah. Oh, it's like you can't move in there,
You can't move, and your head looks all fucking weird.
Yeah.
It's like never looks right.
Okay, okay. Yeah. I want to get to my next favorite moment. So,
well, she's typing on the computer.
She's typing, and it turns out there's a, like, someone, they've been
God
hacked.
God knows what she's doing. She gets an alert.
They've been hacked.
Yeah, what was she doing before?
I don't know. She's just in there, she goes, oh, no, it says, what does it say, like, Code Tiger,
yeah,
for your eyes only, and it's like
everything is like an endangered speech.
She's like, "Oh my god, what did it say?
The security code or something?
The security code has been compromised.
Yes,
compromised. Yeah.
Oh my god,
I have to go tell the boss, and she goes to see her boss, Black Willow, and she stops her door, and the secretary's like, "You can't go in there. She's in a budget meeting.
She's in a budget meeting."
The thing I love is that she walks past two. This is I hate talking about people look, but. The two women she walks past are like normal human beings.
Yes, they are normal.
They're dressed
people.
For an office.
This woman works
She's
in an office. It's
wearing
fine.
A leather zipper dress with her breasts flowing.
Yeah.
Out. It's nuts looking.
Yeah, so you're gonna get it's about to get crazier, man.
So she's like, oh, it's an emergency. Let me in. She's like, okay,
I'll
go ahead
you
on.
In.
And so she walks in. There's a guy. There's her boss. Okay, Julie Strain. On a Stairmaster in a leopard print bikini.
Like high cut, weird.
It's like it's like an exercise outfit.
No, it's a leotard, but it's like insanely high cut and revealing. Yeah.
And she's talking to like some random ass old white guy
show
with a clipboard.
And she's like, what's going on? And then and you're like, what? You saying that to me? I'm screaming that.
Somebody established what planet this is. You look insane.
And then it cuts to the other shot of the room and there's just some old guy with a clipboard standing there, and you're like, what the fuck kind of budget meeting is this? What kind of office space
like
is
not
this?
Only does she look nuts, but she's on a Stairmaster while a guy is standing behind the door area.
Yeah.
Like he's not it's not like it's comfortable.
That's why the door was locked, so no one opens it on him.
God,
it's a budget meeting.
So good.
What the fuck are they talking about?
Budgets.
She's got to get her steps in. I don't know, man.
Holy shit. Well, what do they say here?
The code is compromised, and she sends
like,
them
shit's
out.
Shit's all fucked.
Yeah, she said she's like, oh, we have to go. All our people in the field have been compromised. We need to go pick them up because they're in deep cover in the Warriors Crime Organization.
And then we get the rundown, and she's like, Cobras.
It's the major league scene where she's like, this guy does this, and this guy does this.
Cobra is who we saw at the beginning, and she's an exotic dancer.
Yep.
Then we
Shark
get,
and Scorpion are the porn
infiltrating
actors.
The porn. They're infiltrating the porn, like
and their porn. They're porn actors.
They're just porn actors.
I mean, they're fucking on camera. Yeah. They're not like spies doing anything. They're just
they're
having
just,
sex.
Dude,
on
don't
camera.
Cheapen my favorite scene of the whole movie.
Oh.
Do not cheapen my favorite scene of the whole movie.
I still can't figure.
They're
out.
Spies. Okay?
They're geniuses.
They're masters of their craft. The fucking scene is amazing.
There's
And then they talk about Doc, but they don't show him for some reason, which confused me.
Well, there was somebody else though, wasn't there?
They mention the warrior, and then it cuts to Bagwell like putting on face paint. They're like, he's half Native American.
Oh no, they mentioned the Bond girl.
Well, yeah, he said that already. Cobra.
Not Cobra, the other one. Kim? Scorpion.
Oh, Scorpion.
Kim is not, she's a bad guy.
No, it's Scorpion and
Shark and Scorpion.
Shark and Scorpion are the porno actors.
Okay. God damn this movie.
To be fair, these are their code names. If this was their born human names, I think that would be way funnier.
Yes.
But yeah.
But they're like, okay, we got to go get everybody. Yeah. And then we cut to action with Doc.
Well, she also explains that she's like, you need to go to this airfield and you'll meet whatever his name is.
Oh, yeah.
And he's going to fly you. He's going to take you out to go find Doc. You're going to go save Doc personally. Because we are able to contact the other ones, I guess, or something.
Yeah.
Who the fuck understands anything in this movie?
We don't know who Doc is, though.
But they don't show Doc. They just show, sex. Because Doc wasn't currently fucking someone or couldn't be referenced being butt naked.
Doc was wearing sensible clothing and just sitting around doing nothing. So.
No. Doc. Oh, now Doc. We cut to Doc.
Yeah, Doc.
And Doc is out. We see him driving a Jeep in the middle of a forest.
No, you're right.
Yep.
And then it's
the Rambo scene.
Yeah, he gets a big revolver out of the back of his Jeep and he tucks in his pants.
Then he gets a trank gun.
Okay,
that's right.
And then he gets a giant AK-47
with a rocket launcher attached.
Yeah.
There's a tiny shed in the middle of a clearing.
It's Louisiana. They're in the bayou.
They're in the bayou, but it's a really small shed.
Yeah, it's
a pathetically small.
Someone took four refrigerator
boxes size. How big it is. It's really
based
small.
On the tightness of the shot inside, I would assume it barely fit three people. You know what I mean? Three people deep.
The crew was outside the window shooting in.
Yeah.
It's how small it was. Yeah. And so he opens the door.
He tranks a guard. He opens the guard. There's a guy getting whipped inside.
With what? Did you see? You could barely even see what was in his hand.
No.
It was so tiny.
But he punched. Doc punches out the one guard and frees the guy getting whipped. Tells him to go to the car, get the gun. This guy's flesh is just mangled.
No, he's totally bleeding out of his back.
He's like, hey, just get on out there, buddy. You're
fight,
fine.
Though. He's ready to fight.
Meanwhile, Doc scoops a bunch of treasure off the table.
Okay, before this, they said that they also established the warrior is a crime lord, but he's also into fine art, pornography, and there was a third one.
That might be
diamonds?
One of my favorite shots in the
movie. Diamonds, fine art, and pornography.
Yes. And as they say those three things, it shows Buff Bagwell in a room holding fine art, he's holding a painting out of a frame, and then they're diamonds, and he's holding up a diamond.
And then porn.
But it's all in the same room.
Wait,
it's not different.
The best
part
of that montage was they go porn, and it shows his it shows a shot of him near the camera, and in the background, it's his lackey, and he's there's porn on television.
Of Scorpio.
Of Scorpion and Shark.
Yeah.
And he looks at the lackey, and the lackey gives him a thumbs up, and he goes
Oh, man. Yeah, that part is awesome.
Oh, my God.
That introduction of Warrior was great.
Oh, God.
Great section.
Andy Sidaris.
Master of the craft.
He is. Anyway... So they're back to the shed. He's there's
inside,
all this stuff
the
on
guy
this little shitty ass table.
Oh my God! Yeah,
remember?
So, yes.
There's a golden Buddha,
gems
and coins, and he scoops it all into a bag and then leaves. And then they've got the guards tied up.
They tells the guards,
start walking to Mexico.
He lets the guards go. They get in the Jeep, drive about 20 feet away. Get out of the Jeep, and then he blows up the...
Yeah, he uses a grenade launcher.
He blows up the... You were like, that fucking shed was built to be exploded. Yeah. But then
he blew up the Jeep first,
and I was like, aha, subversion. And then he
blows the shed up.
Yeah, he pulls out another grenade, and you're like, oh, okay.
He's going to blow them both up.
And then I think Doc takes the guy he rescued to see Manuel, who is one of the... one of the warrior's lackeys, and Manuel's like, this guy's stealing. Pop, pop. And Doc's like, oh, my
gosh.
Hold
on. This also has our confusion started because Manuel's sidekick woman.
Kim. I think that's Kim.
Is Kim. But we all were like, wait, was that Cobra? You remember? We were confusing her with Cobra.
Yeah, yes, yeah, yeah, Kim. Yeah. Kim is wearing like a pink leotard or whatever. Everybody else is dressed like you
like
should,
normal
you,
humans yeah. in that situation.
Yeah, she's dressed like a pro wrestler for some reason. It's really weird.
Okay.
And yeah, and that's when Manuel, yeah, he that's when he screams at all of his people, his lackeys. But
well, I think I man, this movie made no sense when I was watching it.
None.
It makes more sense now as we're talking about it.
It does a little bit, yeah.
But like, yeah, so he says that they were Mexican federales.
So this
so
one-
that guy was stealing the stuff that he was trying to leave the country with and selling it to the
federales caught up. So the one guy stole stuff from Manuel. Got caught by the Mexican federales. Doc went and rescued him from the federales, and then Manuel's like, "Well, fuck you," and shot him. And Doc's like, "Oh no!" But then Doc puts a homing device on the back of one of the trucks there. Yeah,
his van,
which will come into play later.
Not his van. It was just like
it was a van.
I think it was a van. He drove a Mercedes.
No, but the homing device was on a van.
Yeah,
okay.
They used it later.
It was a van, but.
There's
so
multiple
yeah,
homing devices.
So Manuel tells
movie.
His lackeys to load the van up with stuff. I don't remember why though.
Because
I,
they have to leave that location because the federales that left will eventually come back.
Yeah,
they've realized
that someone's on to them, so they're
right.
They're
trying
up
to
stakes.
Yeah,
and moving on. To not get caught again.
So I think after that we have
we go back to the plane, right? When what's
Tiger?
Tiger,
let's call him Buffley.
Yeah, Buffley.
Well, they have to meet. Yeah, she
goes
to the hangar
because her assignment is to go and meet Buffley.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah, what the hell was that?
I don't
guy's
remember
name.
Why. I don't know. Buffley or Dudley or something.
Well, the next note.
Literally
I have...
the worst actor in the movie.
Oh god, oh, he's
awful.
In a
I
movie
mean,
of
yes,
bad acting.
Yes and no.
I mean, the Warrior was pretty up
he
there.
Was I mean, some bad. Of the extras are pretty.
He had
great
some of
too.
The best line yeah. deliveries I've ever yeah. seen in a fucking movie, though.
Well, next, the two of the,
his she, introduction was great.
She meets him at the plane yard.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I forget.
After she changes and we get to see your breasts.
Yes.
Right.
Your boss as her boss is telling her what to a voiceover of the boss telling her what to do. We're watching her undress and we were all like, is she still in her office?
Yeah, that's right. Cause she's like getting out of a corset and
yeah.
all that
and
stuff.
It's shot in a way. It's like, she looks like she's still in Julie Strain's
office
but
she's stripping
but
she's down naked and putting on a dress. It's right. weird.
It's nothing. We don't need to see it.
It was so, unused. God,
it doesn't matter.
The amount of stuff you don't need to see that's in this movie.
It could be
amazing.
Like, it's a short film. You don't even need any of this stuff.
Yeah. So next plot point I have after that is introduction of Balkan Skull.
Right.
Talking about stocks.
Well, weren't they? Hold on.
No, because.
They do come soon. It's just.
They meet up at the airport.
That's what I got written down.
Oh, okay.
They get on the plane together and leave.
Yeah.
Buffley and yeah. Tiger.
There's some kind of scene with Buff Bagwell where he's talking about
oh, no.
somebody, or he gets a message on his. Remember
on the screen it says the surf nerd.
We see we get to see Buff right. Bagwell in the present time now, and it's just him in full like Native American makeup and headdress sitting in a wrestling.
He looks like
ring in
a crappy
somewhere.
Ultimate Warrior
yeah.
knockoff.
I
oh, because he wrestles
Tatanka.
A guy. He wrestles a guy.
He's supposed to be an Ultimate Warrior parody, right, in this movie. I thought
there was a wrestler called Tatanka
yeah,
that did
no.
exactly that.
But no, they
look exactly the same.
They bring in some guys like, oh, this guy was caught stealing from you or something, and he beat up a bunch of guys, and he's really tough.
He's real
and
tough.
The Warrior's like, yes, bring him to me. And he's like, if you win, I'll let you go. And the guy's like, sucker punch. And then they just kind of do some shitty wrestling moves. And he, like,
well, no, he goes, I could beat you with one hand tied behind my back. And as he says back, he punches him with the hand he wasn't putting behind his back. But then he just punches him again with the hand he was putting behind his back. So he didn't really beat him that way, but he did knock the guy out. And then he like flexes and poses for no one. There's two people left in that room.
Oh,
that,
yeah, and they,
and they just work for him and they're not.
Yeah.
No one cares.
They bring him into, they bring the rat into the room with the Warrior, and the Warrior's just like sitting in a folding chair in the middle of a goddamn wrestling ring.
He's like meditating in the center of the ring.
That's all I do now.
Oh, man. I love that. That's my favorite shot in the movie. easily.
Because then we get the great face wiping scene.
Oh,
where
he's wiping his makeup off, sitting in a wrestling ring alone
until someone brought him a problem that he could punch.
Yeah.
He could have been there for like hours.
Who knows? And then it cuts to him in his office sitting in front of a computer screen with all this makeup and dumb shit on it. It looks outrageous.
And they're like,
he's like, oh, hey, you should do something.
He does have a mirror.
Yeah, but they're like, they had to give him something to do. So it's like, all right, just pretend like you're wiping off your face.
Yeah. Yes.
But he only wiped off one cheek and just kept wiping.
Yeah.
It
it's like that place is very
Because I'm
clean.
Telling you, on that mirror, it was his lines. He was reading
easily.
He was totally reading those lines.
Yeah.
But that's when he looks at the computer screen and it says the
something about the surf nerds. Two surf nerds are on their way to you.
Right. Yeah. And that's when we cut to the beach montage.
Yes, of the guys rollerblading.
Oh, God.
Dude.
It's so long.
Yeah. Bunch of rollerblading and then a guy with a surfboard.
Why establish those guys as surfers? What did that come into play? Think about it in retrospect.
They're hysterical, Bob.
Yeah.
Hysterical
surfing and beach stuff.
Because that's how wacky they are.
You need to see.
It establishes that they're extreme and wacky.
And the one guy really likes cotton candy. He's got a sensitive side.
He stopped on his way to get a cotton candy. But they meet up on the beach and the one guy's like, I don't even know what the fuck they said to each other.
Like he said, hey,
oh, he goes, oh,
did that
you
thing wet yet? And he's looking at the top of the car,
the
has a surfboard.
That's
yeah.
right. And he's like, nah, man, it's just to get chicks. And he like,
yeah.
Double finger guns at the camera.
And they're like, let's ride. And they get in the car. Yeah, and there's another like, driving montage.
Yeah, because
then like,
we
want to go home. I was like, I want to go back so I can check my stocks.
Yes.
It's like, oh, I'm going to get a shower then. So one guy.
I know.
So we cut to like the one guy in front of the computer and he's like, oh, my stocks are doing terrible. And the other guy's
like, we're only up in four, but we're down in 19. And the other goes, oh, that's bad, man. That's really bad.
We went to business school. Well, I got good thing we have another job.
This is like Sidaris as an auteur right here. There's no reason these two characters, we don't need to know that they changed their clothes. Or that he's a stockbroker, really, at all? Like,
they could have just been marched in to meet him.
Yes.
Or been waiting and watched him beat that other guy up and then introduce them, be like, hi, we're here to do that job.
Yes.
It's insane.
We don't need to see a montage of the beach, then them talk, then go to the house to change their clothes.
Yeah,
it's
we don't need to show it. We saw them in two different outfits before they started explaining who they were.
Well, we don't even need that.
It has a point because
the pool?
Yeah, because they go downstairs.
That has a point.
Yeah, the points are the tits.
Well, hold on.
I know. Yes.
Yes.
For this,
still
movie,
in the bedroom.
I'm saying,
still
like,
funny
story-wise, of course. It's insane to show them changing clothes.
The story is secondary for Andy Sidaris.
Mm. They live in this like luxury beach house.
Yeah.
That is just a like, giant white block.
That has the weirdest layout
I've
ever
seen. They set up that they're terrible stockbrokers, but now they have a job working for the
Warrior
and doing.
So they walk out to the pool and two women that are there. And he's like, "Where'd you get these women?" And he said he just picked them up.
He's like, "I found them.
They're NBA.
They've been there though. He was out doing stuff with his car, and he's like, you know what I'm saying? Like,
yes, when and where and how long have they been there? Yes." Have they been there for days?
I forget what he says to get her to take her top off, but
he goes. So I told him your MBAs, and he goes, "What's your GPA?" And she,
right. Oh, she's
her,
like 38.
She pulls her tits
26.
Out
36. Like she gives her measurements.
Yes,
and she takes her bra off, and they're like, "Whoa!"
They literally. Right. That's not an exaggeration.
No,
there's
like,
two
whoa!
Like glass raising. Whoa!
Yeah,
shots.
If it was a cartoon, their eyes would have bulged out.
Kurt smells one of his favorite, like. Jokes and anything like tropes is the eyeglass raising. There's double in a row in this. Yeah.
And then
insane.
they all like they get dressed and they go out to the car and
they're dressed again. The women are with them.
And then
and they're
like,
in a different outfit. Everybody's wearing a million outfits and none of them are sane.
But they make a remark.
If people didn't change so much, it would be easier to understand.
Yes. Yeah. It's hard to follow.
I said before, like in the beginning, his characters should wear good and bad uniforms. So we kind of know what's going on.
Dude, it's insane. All the women have this either blonde hair or black hair, and all the men have long ponytails or square heads. And you're just like,
they all look like John Bates.
They're just
look like porn stars.
Meat.
Everyone looks like a porn star. And you're just like, I don't know who anyone is.
Yeah. One of the women says something like, when they're getting in the car, she's like, am I going to regret what happens tomorrow morning?
He goes, we can come back here and play some Twister. And she's like, and then she says that. And then the other girl goes, I hope so. And they laugh. And you're like, what? What? That was like three robots.
Who are you?
Yeah, those were three robots that were broken trying to have a conversation.
Like, as Matt said, and as I was trying to make, these characters could have been just walked into the Warriors' office.
Yeah.
We didn't need to see any of that. Like that 10 minute, maybe 15. I don't even know how long that was.
It wasn't that long. It was probably.
It was so ungodly superfluous.
Now we top that with Cobra traveling.
No! This is awesome.
This. The next eight minutes are excruciating. It's insane.
Well, we go to Cobra's home. She lives by herself in her home.
Yes.
And she's changing for a long period of time. So we see her.
We are listening. And the song, man. The song is amazing.
It's terrible.
It was just so late 90s. Like,
yeah.
Fucking sexy rock and roll. Oh, my God. I love it.
She changes her clothes and then she walks out of her house, gets into her car. Her car then has a driving montage throughout Beverly Hills.
Yes. We're looking at buildings and shops. And
palm trees, Rodeo Drive. It's
pulling
like,
into a garage.
Yeah.
And then walking from the garage.
Multiple blocks. We were all just like, why would you park that far away from your destination? Just park on the street. There has to be something. Parking.
It's a movie.
Christ.
We could have walked into the store and we'd be like, okay.
Oh.
Look, it's Cobra.
Plot.
Why does she need to come out of her house?
We need to hear three verses of that song. That's why.
No, it's because Andy Sidaris is like, I can't write a scene where her breasts are out in public. So I have to start her out at home where she's changing, have a sexy changing scene, and then get her to the where she needs to
be. I love that he feels like he might lose somebody along the way. But like, well, I got to show her, make sure they see her get into the car, drive to Beverly Hills, and then... You know, park it.
I wish she stopped for gas or something. Like,
oh man,
so.
I wish she stopped in another store before going to her final destination.
Well, she goes in a jewelry store, right?
Yes. Yeah. And she talks to the guy.
She makes it.
She goes into the back room of a jewelry store.
And there's like a illicit like diamond deal.
These are my diamonds from Russia.
Here's your receipt.
This has nothing to do with the Warrior, though, right?
Yeah, it does because she's undercover. Yeah, she's picking them up for the Warriors.
Yeah, she's supposed to take it to like a security box and then destroy the key and walk away.
Right,
but then this like dude comes out and
it's like she leaves.
She leaves the room and then this dude steps out of the shadows. Like
giant
as soon as she steps by where he is, he steps out.
The guy looks like John Benjamin's brother.
Yes.
He shoots him
with a silenced gun and steals the money she just paid him.
And then we go back to her and the music?
She gets back in her car, and then we watch
her drive her fucking car again for like a whole minute. It's insane. You're like, wait, we just did this. And now we're doing it again? Are you fucking kidding me?
And then we go to Vegas for a bunch of establishing shots.
I flipped out here. His pacing is too weird for me. We hear singing,
and then it reveals a headless shot
of an Elvis impersonator,
and then it's a long fucking montage of Vegas.
Yeah,
just shots of Vegas
forever. Like so many. I was losing my mind, being like, if we never see that Elvis guy again, I'm gonna flip out.
Thank God he was a character.
I know. It seemed like we were never gonna see it again. That's how long we were looking at shots of fucking casinos.
Right, and then
shots everyone has seen. You know what I mean? It's not new.
Like, it's the Bellagio.
It's Treasure Island. It's the Mirage.
We get it.
It's Vegas.
It's
okay.
Insane.
Well, it does reveal that it's a. It's
what was his name? I forgot.
Gerald Okamura.
He's an Asian.
We've done movies on this podcast that he has starred in, such as Time Burst, The Final Alliance. But he's in Big Trouble in Little China, a bunch of shit. He's famous.
But he's an Asian. In this part, he's playing an Asian Elvis impersonator named Elvis Fu.
Elvis Fu. Who I thought should have been called King Fu. I thought it would have been a better name, but I don't know.
I think Elvis Kung Fu.
Elvis Kung Fu.
Yeah, at least they didn't make it worse somehow.
Yeah.
like on the level of Andy Sidaris racism.
Yeah.
This is actually on the lower end.
Yeah.
So
Elvis Foo.
It turns
Elvis
out Foo. She is a he is a contact for
Julie Strain.
What yes. is her character name? Willow.
Willow Black.
Willow Black.
She
because we do see her change and get she changes.
Yeah, we watch her.
She literally watched people change to get ready to go on a transportation.
I screamed that at some point. I was like, every other scene is a woman getting
dressed
and then yes. going somewhere.
It's so much.
Heavens, constantly.
She travels to Vegas,
yeah.
and then revealed that he's singing and she is at the show watching.
Yes,
him. Yes,
and he's an agent for Lethal, and yes. she's there.
He's not a lady, so it's confusing.
Yeah. She's there to get him so they can go extract Shark and Scorpion, who are infiltrating the nearby porn ring.
Right.
Illicit porn ring, I guess.
But the only only thing she knows... Oh, no, she doesn't know anything, right?
They know, like, what kind of car they have.
Yes, that's it.
So they're going to go search for them together. And Fu has a lot of Asian stereotype lines.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
He was a good sport in the 80s, 90s.
Well, I mean, if you wanted to work in white Hollywood, it was hard not to do that.
Right.
White people are terrible.
I think Andy Sidaris kind of fills out that role. Doesn't
yeah, yeah, I forget what happened after that, but my next note is fake Al because of that.
Well, yeah, we cut back to... Al.
Manuel and Kim.
Manuel and Kim, they pull up to another shed.
Lake House, I think.
A lake house.
Because they mentioned it comes. I think the lake house comes
up. It says really big fuel storage on it.
Yeah. Yeah, and, okay, that's the lake house.
Well, when they left from the last pace, he was like, this is going to be a long drive. How are you going to keep me entertained?
And she's like, I'll.
Whatever.
I'll blow you the whole time.
They intimated that they were just driving a very long distance.
So they've been driving. Thank God we didn't see it.
Yeah, I know. We've been doing all this other stuff the whole time. Now we cut back to them. As soon as they get out of the car, he gets a fax that's like, Doc's a fucking double agent, and he goes, nah, all right, let's go drive to the other place.
But wait a minute. The most important part of the scene is that there's an owl, a fake robotic owl.
An insanely fake owl.
Insanely fake.
They zoom in way too close in on for that one.
Yeah. Like, you could just see, like, it's doing the, like, a robotic head turn.
Why include this in the movie?
And, like, Kim is complaining about it for the entire scene. And it's like,
it's back again.
It's like a 3-minute long scene. It's just under all the dialogue, you just hear, whoo. And then at the end, Kim takes a shotgun and blasts it apart.
It blows up.
And Manuel's like, those are endangered. And she goes, not anymore, it's not. And
but
I'm
no,
like,
wait,
yes,
you made it more endangered.
More endangered, you fucking idiot.
Yeah. But think about what it was pertinent to.
Dude,
like, it doesn't have to. Okay. I understand.
It's laying the seeds, Bob. She's a monster. She's more than just. Manuel's.
I know your
argument's
gonna be it's a character
like,
moment.
Yeah,
I get it. I'm saying for a low budget fucking movie, why did they bother? He could like, you know what I mean? Like the tits make sense for this movie.
Sure,
he's trying to show as much nudity as possible, but showing an exploding owl puppet.
They really wanted to appeal to the animal cruelty crowd too.
I'm sure it just made him laugh. I don't know, man.
They must have just had like an owl puppet for something else, and they were like, well, we can blow this up.
Maybe Andy Sidaris just hates owls. Maybe he had an owl outside of his window that he couldn't do anything about because it was endangered.
He had something to say, is what you're saying.
Yeah.
Yes.
This is his statement about owls.
Yes.
Fucking disgusting creatures.
Auteur, filmmaker, and anti-owl activist. Andy Sidaris.
It's just like, you understand what I'm saying,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, no, yes. I get it.
Bring the movie to even a deader halt so a woman can shoot a robotic owl.
The movie thought it was really funny.
Yeah, it did.
It had a lot of scenes that ended with, like, this was a joke, but it's almost like they were like dad jokes. Or something like
there
that.
There are so many. Like, they used a, I need to get something off my chest, like, three times?
It was twice.
It was twice?
Yeah.
I thought it was three. But,
I mean, I guess if you've ever listened to or watched Malibu Express.
It's three.
Why am I complaining about an owl when the Buffingtons exist, I guess?
Yeah, I know. That's what I'm saying. Like, he likes weird, wacky nonsense.
Like, non sequitur shit that just happens in a movie. Yeah.
So after that,
which I kind of appreciate.
Yeah, I appreciate it. It's fine. It's just like all that drive time, and then the owl happens. Like, what is... I don't know what's going on, and we're doing this? Like, it's fine if you're going to make it aside when I understand what's going on. All right, go ahead.
So, yeah, after that, they confirm that Doc has a double agent. And then my next note is Shark and Scorpion dance. I guess they're doing their porno dance.
They're in the hotel room, like, and he was dancing in the room like a weirdo the whole time for some reason. They're in their hotel room talking about how fucking groovy it is that they're like gonna bust this porno ring soon because they get a call from... Wait, has that happened yet? No, we gotta get the bumbling guys gotta meet Buff Bagwell before that,
The two surf nerds.
Oh, they do.
Surf nerd stockbroker guys.
Yeah, they have to meet Buff Bagwell.
That happens, and then
Warrior.
So they go to meet the shitty Ultimate Warrior. And he says, I don't understand. This is so confusing.
They show up and he goes, man, it's genius. You guys pretending to be surfers, but actually being assassins. And I was like, what about that genius?
I don't understand why that's necessary.
Yeah, it doesn't make any sense.
They also are surfers. They're not pretending.
Well, one of them was rollerblading and the other one specifically said he doesn't surf. He just uses it to fuck.
So the Bagwell, so the Warrior sends them on the mission to infiltrate his porn ring
and kill
and find the lethal people.
Yeah,
right.
Kill Shark and Scorpion.
So let's just make sure we establish that.
Oh, and all the mission while we skipped over something that we've only a few times mentioned, but it was something that we kept asking in the whole movie. The Warrior has to eventually, needs to pay someone named the Hard Drive.
Yes,
the guy who actually
hacked
the system.
You're right.
To the movie justice, there were multiple times where I was just like, who the fuck is
Hard Drive?
Yeah.
So like, it's weird.
I'm saying,
weird plot point.
When he gives the two surfer idiots the mission they're on is to go into his own porn operation.
Yes. And
weed out who is the lethal person.
No, he knows who they are.
I'm saying, but you want them to be killed, right?
Yes.
That's the mission.
That's the point.
Murder them.
Hold on. In the result of the hack, do they know exactly who these people are? Because they were just like, it's
Mac,
Doc.
If they didn't think about the scene.
No, they
do.
The
process of elimination.
No, they have to because they get the facts out in the woods. And that's how the bad guys get the facts out in the woods. Yeah. And that's how they know the Doc is the bad guy.
Okay,
but even if they didn't, it's not like they're in a set with a bunch of fucking people. You know what I'm saying? What I'm trying to establish here is that the next scene is them shooting porn with the two of them and two other people that have to be the two agents he knows about.
Yeah.
There's no one else there.
Yes, that's why I asked the question, because he would have to know that the two people he's about to hire to do a porno are the fucking moles. This whole plot line is really fucking fuzzy.
All right. So Shark and Scorpion do a porn dance. We'll get to the porn stuff, because that's a whole other can of worms that's going to explode.
God.
All right. So after that, Fu and Willow are talking about getting Shark and Scorpion, and at one point Willow turns around and her boobs catch Fu in the face and knock him halfway
the
room.
Dude, he does a full front flip like he got fucking lariated by Zangief.
And he makes a remark about foreplay. And then then they're saving. So Tiger and Buffly are saving Doc after he's been outed, and there's a bunch of gunfight stuff. And then they get pinned down behind a tree.
Oh, the tree.
And they're like, we can't hit this guy with guns.
We can't hit this guy
with guns. Hold on, you skipped over. Okay.
Hold on. Let's finish this, and then we'll go to that.
No, I want to talk about this scene because I love it. Doc is standing there, and the Mercedes pulls up, and he's like, I'm found out. He hops in a Jeep and tries to get away, but they all pull guns on him, and he's standing there with all these guns on him. And then whatever pilot guy shoots one of them.
Oh, yeah.
And he fully disarms everyone around him and could murder all of them and then chooses to just run away.
Yeah, he just runs away.
He runs like 50 feet away, hides behind something, and then starts shooting.
It could have been all over.
Dude, he knocked them all to the ground and disarmed them.
Yeah.
He had a gun. And he's going to kill everyone.
He's not averse to murdering them.
Yeah. I was like, wait, is he trying not to murder him? And then he started shooting at them. And I was like, no, he's trying to murder them. That makes no sense.
Yeah.
He had a gun in his hand. He was 2 feet from literally everyone that he understood to be a bad person. And they were on the ground. And he ran away.
There's no movie if he does that.
Yeah. We get the gunfight. And then there's
the standoff.
The standoff. And they're like, oh, here's this explosive tipped crossbow bolt that we set up earlier.
Since we can't hit him with a bullet, maybe we have an explosive that we can get him that way. And you're like, okay.
Oh, yeah, we skipped that sex scene.
Yeah, there was a...
They had sex. Yeah, they had sex in a fucking cabin.
Just assume between every scene there's a sex
fucking
scene.
Yeah, everybody's fucking.
The pilot and the glass-eyed tech woman fucked in a cabin. While
surprise,
they talked
surprise.
About
so
exploding.
Like they said, we can't hit him with line of sight of a bullet. But we have an explosive arrow that we could maybe hit him with.
Yeah.
And then what happens is the bad guy
steps all the way out.
He shoots him right in the chest with the explosive tips arrow and he explodes. Okay. But you're like, wait.
A gun, anything.
And from the movie's
perspective, knife you threw could have killed that guy.
Yeah, but from the movie's perspective, you're like, why did you do that? Because now... It should have been the guys hiding behind that shed door or whatever, and he's...
Why the fuck didn't they shoot that at Manuel's car?
I don't know.
Instead of one guy. Turn around.
Because they couldn't get him.
All they had to do was pivot 180 degrees, and they would be looking at Manuel's car that's 50 feet from them, and they could have blown it up.
But they save... Buffley and Tiger save Doc, and they get out of there. And then we go back to Cobra, who was relaxing by her pool, and a guy comes in saying he's the new pool guy.
But I said the old guy had a real bad headache.
Headache.
But we know it's the guy who killed
because he has the earring Russian John Benjamin guy.
Right. Yeah. But Cobra gets a alert from Willow that lets her know.
I love this scene.
Yeah,
Willow's talking to Fu, and she's like, "Look, I got this phone. If I dial it, like, it'll tell her that she's in danger and should come home.
But the bad guys will
know. The bad guys could intercept it, and then they'll know that I told her to come home, and then they'll know where she's going. And you're like,
what
the fuck? And then you're like, how does this work? Then she's like, you gotta use it. And she's like, you're right. And she uses it. So fucking Cobra's thing goes off.
And the
other guy's got a thing, and it goes off. And you're like, what? What system is that?
They were like,
what is this?
How do we make this scene work? And he's like, had Julie Strain say all that bullshit so that that would happen.
How is the enemy hijacking the phone signal?
She should have just said,
it's
if
like
I
a
use
pager,
phone,
I would imagine, yeah. Right? She's dialing a
it
pager.
Doesn't make, no, it makes no sense.
Oh my God.
She should have just said, if I use this phone, a Mexican standoff will happen at a pool.
Yeah.
That's what she should have said.
Which is what... Which
I didn't want to use it, Foo, because she might die I know if I press this button, she'll be in a Mexican standoff.
Which is what happens.
And she kills the guy.
She kills him, and then she like gets up and she makes a snarky remark about like, oh, I hope it doesn't clog up my filter.
Right.
And then
she changes, right?
She goes, man, my pool guy's gonna be pissed off. I hope he doesn't clog my filter. Also, with the guy getting killed made awesome noises. He went like,
she goes inside. And
changes,
the next,
right?
Yeah, changes.
The next scene is
presumably
her
after getting a shower.
I love how much changing is. She took a shower. It shows her putting on these like insane like
zebra
leggings.
Yeah.
That go all the way up.
Which I retained. She did not keep on.
No, she definitely did.
Because it immediately then cuts to her walking out of the house in fucking leather pants. And you're like, you're not wearing leggings.
I think
under
that
it's
too tight.
She gets in her car, and I'm just like, kill me now. She's going to drive
before
again.
Before she gets in her car, she passes by the pool.
No, she drives by it on her way out of the driveway.
Oh, I thought she walked past it.
No, she gets in her car, and she starts backing out the driveway, and she looks to her right, and the pool guy's
been dead in her front yard for God knows how long.
And he's
long.
In a Jeep with no door and blood running down his face.
He is shot directly in the side of the fucking head on the street in broad daylight. She's taking showers, changing outfits constantly. Who the hell knows what
Matt,
she
there's
did
also
in
a dead man floating in her pool.
Yes!
This is her domestic
house. She's insane. She's a sociopath.
Yep.
It's madness.
And then she drives
the guy to take
then
a shower
and try on some clothes.
Yeah, and cue the music. Cool. The music comes back.
Yeah,
right?
And then we get so to watch her drive
to the airport.
Fly to Dallas.
Then she parks in the. Then she parks. Don't. She parks in a garage. We see her get out of the car, get her bags, and she walks. It's like
it's long,
good
man.
God,
I don't. They loved playing that music and watching this woman walk.
There was a shot of her walking. You know those things that go over top of a road.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like from building to
the
building.
Sky bridge.
Sky bridge. She's walking on a sky bridge, then it zooms out to show us she is in fact on a sky bridge.
You're like,
ah! What the fuck? I get it. She's getting on a plane. Jesus Christ.
Then it cuts to a plane. You're like, you could have. God damn it.
Just go right there. So much walking.
You don't even need to show the plane. She could have showed up at the next scene and been like, I just flew here. What's going on? You know, it doesn't need to. A line of dialogue could have covered all of it.
It's unreal.
It's amazing.
Well, the line of dialogue has already covered it because we skipped the where Black Willow or what Willow Monster. What is her name?
Willow Black.
Yeah.
She calls.
How dare you, Mike?
She calls some Australian guy who is trying his damnedest not to sound Australian, and he explains everything we just watched happen. He's like.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, I told her to just come back, and Willow's like, but that's terrible. Now everybody knows where we're gonna be, and you're like, what are you people saying?
Well, okay, that.
How does everyone know where you're gonna be?
Now hold on, that guy's new. His name is what was his name?
Fuck
Williamson.
Because him, he's two guys in that
Jackson.
Room. Jackson
Jordanson,
and his lackey guy is what's his name?
Dietrich.
That's important.
Yeah.
Yes.
Apparently,
we never met these guys until that scene when the phone call scene
where he explains that he just told everybody to come back. And she's like, but
to the lethal headquarters.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In Dallas.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. So now we get the boardroom scene, right?
No, the boardroom scene comes after they've rescued everybody, which means we need to go rescue Shark and Scorpion.
Yes, that was so here's
Matt's
the best
favorite scene
this
in the movie.
It's the best scene in cinema incredible. History, maybe. I don't
so,
even.
So what we have here
like we established before, is their mission is to kill the infiltrators of the porn ring,
so
right?
What we have are two members of Lethal who are pretending to be porn stars. So that they can figure out how to break into this porn factory.
For
that
reasons.
That we still don't even understand.
Factory's a bit of an embellishment.
Well, it's a means of production and it has the means of...
Oh, you, okay, I thought you meant the physical...
Everything about it, it's practically a porn factory.
It's a ring.
They film it in this part. They edit it and copy it in this part and then they just get it the fuck out of there.
We didn't know about the editing room yet, though. It's important to note.
But so we have two lethal agents pretending to be porn stars to figure out how to break into this place. Then they knock on the door. It gets answered by guess who? Our fucking Balkan Skull answer the door.
Now
they are hitmen pretending to be pornographers. What proceeds to happen?
Oh, hold on.
It's as if.
You need to know
two people who were pornographers.
Hold on, you need to know
two people who are porn stars.
Hidden camera.
Okay. It doesn't matter.
No, that matters because it makes it dumber.
How?
Is that
they all just do what they're supposed to do.
That's what I'm saying.
There's no subterfuge. There's no murder.
But what I'm saying, the Shark and Scorpion have a hidden camera to, oh my God,
to see the buttons.
How you get into the button code to get into the room. And they did that for some reason.
Why is that
then,
so important?
What Matt said, they go in there and they... all legitimately without pause make a normal pornography
men film that two people
Shark
fucking.
And Scorpion are fucking. They're vulnerable. They could be taken out at any moment.
They just film it.
They film it and
they
all
leave.
It's incredible.
That none of them needed to be spies. None of them did anything they were hired
In my mind, my first thought was, okay, I'm forgetting some kind of reason that this happened. Because number one, I also don't understand why Shark and Scorpion are just, they're not finding anything out for Lethal. Right?
Yeah.
Yes, they are. They figured out how to get in.
Yeah. But they're
supposedly
they
say they needed to use the generalizing camera to see where like the back room they're just, was, even though it's a giant fucking door.
Well, I'm saying they come back,
but there's a screen in front of the door.
But you can still see the door frame above the screen because the screen's not as high as the door frame.
Yeah, but they're just like, oh, they went back
here. They're also fucking spies, Mike. They should be able to find a door behind a goddamn screen.
Well, I'm saying
screen.
If they're trying to record the code, there's no fucking way you're going to get the code.
The code's from the outside. They're already in at that point.
Yeah.
They remarked that they saw him walk behind this screen.
Oh, okay. I actually
like it was
forgot
the Wizard of Oz, Mike.
Oh, now yeah. makes a lot of sense.
I thought something else was happening here.
No.
I see.
But they only needed the camera to get in.
After it's all over, they film the porn, they all leave. Shark and Scorpion come back and use the secret code to get back in, and then they're like, there was something behind the screen. I thought something pertaining to the plot was back there. But what was actually back there was the video of them fucking.
And
a bunch
of, other videos.
And, equipment. It was, the whole, all the processing for
sure,
the porn ring.
Yes, but what's the secret that they did?
It's not illegal.
What I'm saying is,
it wasn't like a snuff film. They didn't get killed.
Also, according to the continuity of the movie, they've already been in that room. Because they showed the shot earlier in the movie that they've already been infiltrating that room and fucking there. So what I'm saying is they were there.
Well, they've been in the porn warehouse. They haven't been in the
back room. The editing room.
They didn't know the. God damn it, Bob.
There's nothing there for them to figure out.
Because it all
they're like, hey, this is a place where they make porn, and now
we already knew that.
Also, they edit in the back room. Okay,
listen, Bob, it is an investigation of a multi-layered criminal conspiracy.
I know,
not all of them are going to be winners, man. But you got to chase down every fucking lead if you are part of the Legion of Enforcement of Total Harmony and Law, lady.
Fine.
I just didn't find anything out.
No, the end of that.
The bad guys didn't kill them, and they barely found any new information.
Well, then they leave.
There was a door in the room that they had yet to even go in before, and now they're
they were just fucking. They couldn't go. Hey, can we hang out in your back room after we fuck?
They get the tape of them fucking, and they
steal their.
And now there's nothing here except tapes of us fucking.
And now
they get in their car.
Oh my god!
Dude, they get in their car. They turn a corner, and guess who's waiting for them? Falcon Skull with guns
to kill them out in broad daylight next to an active road,
not in a private building behind a security.
They could have been shot dead so easily.
They
could have
slit their throats at any minute earlier.
God damn it!
Quietly in private,
killing them would have been so easy in there.
Idiots. Insane.
Oh, and then before the shooting scene, there is that scene where they're running out. Scorpion and Shark are running out of the building, and woman is just running. It's like running in heels, and she looks like falling all over the place.
She is barely
also during the shootout with the surfer idiots. Is when Fu and Widow Black show up.
Yeah,
they all kind of join together.
Scorpion and Shark both get shot, but non-fatally. Yeah. And so Fu and Willow come in and save them, and they drive off.
Scorpion's a fucking beast. She gets shot in the shoulder,
and the other guy
gets shot in the leg. He has to have a cane later.
No, that's the different guy.
You're thinking of Buffley.
Buffley gets shot and has a cane.
That guy's out.
That guy's out for the rest of the movie.
You're right. Okay, you're right.
They're
both out for the rest.
Wait,
of the movie.
Wait, which one
right.
is the male?
So, we got him.
Is the male? Is the guy LA. Scorpion or
I don't
Shark?
Know.
And they never,
Shark is the guy.
Shark is the guy. Okay,
I thought
Scorpion is. Yeah, that makes sense. I guess.
Anyway,
so
Primeny, they save them.
They save them,
the
and then there's
Bumblers bumble off.
And then is that the boardroom scene or? No, wait. Before that is the sex scene with Cobra and some other
Doc. Cobra's taking a very extensive shower. In her bikini. And then Doc shows up in the bathroom, and then
they
fuck.
And then they play.
To the first 5 seconds of The Little Mermaid.
Right.
And
it's really.
And then
really
I think
accurate.
It's the boardroom scene.
Yeah.
Where they're all arguing.
Because now everybody's back.
Everyone's back.
They're back in, what was it, Denver? What was it again?
Dallas. They're arguing, how did this leak get out? And people
Who's
are accusing Jordanson of being the mole.
He's like, what the fuck, man?
And who's at the meeting? Okay, it's in charge of the meeting. It was Widow Black. It's, yeah, but there's
Jordanson, Black, Doc, Widow Black,
Dietrich,
Cobra,
Tiger,
Buffley,
Shark, and Scorpion.
Shark and Scorpion aren't there. Shark and Scorpion
injured.
are
yeah,
benched for the rest of the movie.
You're yeah,
right, they are.
Okay.
They're out.
Right, and so they're trying. Yeah, they're trying to wonder how
Fu.
This happened.
I think Fu is there too.
No, Fu's not there.
Oh,
he's not there.
Well, yeah, they always left behind
Black's like buddy.
Yeah,
he's in there a little bit more. But anyway, so they had this big argument, and then they basically break it off and like, we gotta go take down the warrior.
We gotta go to his lake house.
Yeah, and get back all the treasure he stole.
Yeah, because also at this point Buff Bagwell's been like, you didn't kill him, you fucked up. So
yeah,
I'm gonna tell you to do something else.
Yeah,
and
then
I give you guys one more chance.
Yeah. And then Buff Bagwell fucks Kim in the middle of like a bowling alley.
Yes, that's when because Manuel shows up to be
It didn't go anywhere. Because Manuel, remember that whole subplot didn't go anywhere.
No.
Manuel was like, she's out shopping, and then he leaves, and it turns out that his girlfriend was
waiting to fuck
in a
Buff Bagwell,
bowling alley gym. fuck the warrior.
Yeah.
Grease up each other and fuck. It was dumb.
It wasn't grease. It was body paint. It was great.
Yeah, they body
paint. Oh, yeah. It's a body paint sex scene.
They body paint each other.
Yeah.
And then is the lake house thing where the lethal people pull up and they're like 200 feet from the driveway.
Well, then.
Like, incomplete.
Hold on.
Right?
At the end of the meeting, Jordanson says to Widow Black, Willow, I need you to.
Yeah, it's a bunch of paperwork.
For paperwork.
But then you find out that they're fucking.
Yeah, and they have sex.
Right. And then she says, don't you think anybody knows about him? He goes, well, they're all spies.
I hope so.
Yeah. Which at first I was like, I thought he was the mole. And she was in. For a moment, I thought Widow Black and him were the bad guys that were the leaks.
Yeah, the last scene made you think
that
Jordanson was the leak.
Yeah,
it makes
sort
of sense
that fucked him. And I was like, so
wait, is Widow Black?
Is she a bad guy
on this? Okay, because she
weird.
Just helped. Okay,
she was one of the people accusing him in the last scenes. It's
labyrinthine.
So there's a sex scene with those two, and then the next plot point I have is. When Wu and Willow are in a hotel room and Bulk and Skull come in and, like, jump them and capture them.
You mean Fu?
Fu, sorry.
She fucks Jordanson in the morning. She's like, I'm going to order breakfast and then get Fu to come pick me up. And it cuts to, what does it cut to from that? No, I can't remember. Yeah, well.
Yeah, I don't remember.
Yeah. But they get captured.
They are captured.
Yes.
So now the rest of the lethal people who are still not Shark and Scorpion, not Widow Black and Fu, the other ones, they have to go to
Buffley,
the lake house.
Tiger, Kim, Cobra, and
well, the
Doc.
First car that shows up
is the
Jordanson.
Warrior.
No, the first car that shows up.
Well, okay. So then,
all know about a lake.
Yeah, there's a lake. So they basically go looking for a lake house. But they're looking for the homing beacon that Doc put on the van in the beginning of the movie, but it only has a 5-mile radius, so they basically have to go all around this lake looking for it.
Yeah.
But the first person that gets to the lake is Jordanson and Dietrich.
Yeah, Jordanson and Dietrich go out there, and it's like,
and
oh,
shoots
we're
Jordanson
gonna...
in the chest.
Yeah, it's like, oh, Dietrich is the bad guy.
Oh, shit. And that's when Manuel and Kim show up.
Yep.
But before they get there, Manuel's like, this is a bomb. I'm putting it in with the money. We give him the money.
And
we start
blow
driving
him
away.
Up.
We blow him up. And she's like, that's a great plan. And we were all like, you're blowing up $1 million when that could just be an empty case.
Yeah, like it doesn't need to have the money in it. Why are you doing this?
So then they meet up and they do an exchange.
Why are you doing this at all if you're blowing the money up? What's the point?
Well, he does look inside the case. They do
he's
an
like,
exchange.
Oh, there's monies.
Yeah, he does. Yeah.
And you find out he's hard drive. He was the leak. He takes the money. Then Kim pulls out a gun and looks over his shoulder. And
like
then
there's
he
a
looks
wink.
Over his shoulder. And then Manuel's like, what is going on? And then they both shoot him.
Yep.
Right?
Yeah, they shoot it, but one shoots him once, the other shoots him again, and then they take the bomb out of the briefcase and they toss it into the Manuel's car.
They blow up Manuel's car.
Yeah.
They blow him up.
And then
by that point, that's when they find the beacon on Jefferson's car. And they're like pulling up, walking up.
Meanwhile,
he's not dead.
He's not dead, but meanwhile, sorry, my wife texted me. the warrior has Willow dress up in like this American bikini. And brought to the ring where she's going to
he's
wrestling Fu and her.
And that's pretty much them until the end of the movie.
Yes.
Yeah, I'll beat them to death with my bare hands.
It's a cross-cutting thing with everything we see happening versus this happening, is them fighting in a ring. You know, like all the other stuff,
once the gunfight starts.
Once
the
gunfight
stuff,
starts.
Yes. It starts,
but I'm saying nothing really interesting happens on the warrior end.
No, it's all that fight.
But we're skipping ahead because the warrior pulls up at the lake house and he's wearing the weird looking suit that's all tight on his arms, and he tells the guys like to watch. Like the guys tell him that they have Widow Black and Fu, lethal people are shown to be parked like 100, 200 feet away
from the house,
in the middle of fucking nowhere,
right next to a tree, to the point where the one dude can't open the driver cannot
open
his
door.
And then it shows Buff Bagwell tell the two tell Balkan Skull guys, he's like all right, they're right over, he knows exactly where they are because he can fucking see them with his eyes. Yeah. Man, he just goes, they're right over there,
they're right there
behind the house, you know, take care of it.
So what did they, how do they do it?
By getting somehow they sneakily get a bulldozer.
Bulldozer scene.
And do it quietly enough to get it close enough to the car to bulldoze it against a tree.
And without them being able to get
struggling
to get out. But also while the bulldozer's rising, they're on top of the car just like shooting wildly into it.
It's insane.
But somehow they get out of the car and there's a gunfight forever.
Which is like 5 feet apart.
It just takes a long time. Yeah. Who shows up to save them?
Well,
they're having a shootout there.
Because the two surfer dudes go down to the dock. Remember, they get blown up.
So that comes a little later.
That's when Buff dude gets shot in the leg. Gets shot in the leg, and the two lackey guys run away.
Yeah.
Oh, wait. Does some blow up, or is that later?
That's
later. Yeah, there are a lot of
explosions. So I think Buffley and Doc get out of there, and then they come back. They all regroup, and they come back.
And they're like, we got to go to his house and just fucking
murder everyone. And Buffley comes back with like a metal cane, which will come into play in a bit.
Now is the wrestling shit starts, because we're seeing them beat up while they're like getting to it.
Right. It's basically that he hired a wrestler to wrestle.
Yeah, that's essentially
what he did. And
there's clotheslines.
He's super greased
at this point, right?
Oh my god!
Yeah, Buff Bagwell was a terrible wrestler, and
he's like greased
terrible
to the max
this.
Here. Like he is buttered.
Oh, there was this
and it was just dripping with coconut oil.
There's so many useless sex scenes. It's amazing. I did like how you guys kept being like, "Man, I hope Fu gets laid at some point."
I'm real disappointed about that.
Well, I just wanted someone that wasn't like a porn star to have a sex scene. I think that's what
the point of these movies.
We wanted the Frank Reynolds sex scene is what we
wanted. Yeah, I wanted a Frank Reynolds sex scene. That Andy Sidaris, Fu as Andy Sidaris having sex. That's what I wanted.
So after that, it's mainly the four people, Cobra, Doc, Buffley, and Tiger assaulting the lake house. There's lots of gunfights. There is a they blow up the fuel storage,
fuel storage.
That was where the owl was. They kill the main warrior lackey guy.
Wasn't that where the owl was?
Yeah, that was where
the owl was.
They blow that up. She blows it up with her cane.
Or no, Buffley's cane missile.
Yeah,
the cane missile. Which comes out of nowhere, but
How did he not know that he had a missile launcher?
Because it was from Lethal, and she knew about it, but he didn't.
Yeah,
it doesn't matter.
And then they corner Balkan Skull down by the dock, and one of them shoots the engine of a speedboat,
and it blows up the whole dock.
And then
they survive like cartoon characters.
Yeah, yeah, they're like they're clothes are blown off.
It's like Yosemite Sam getting a bomb go off.
Exactly.
Yeah, like
it's kind of cool.
They exist in a separate universe from everyone else. Yeah,
and they kill all the rest of the lackeys.
They go inside to stop the fight, right? Because Julie Strain is still she like.
Are they fighting there? Yeah, I guess
they're fighting in the ring.
Strain
No. There's a no. They get Dietrich. They get Dietrich, and it's like you're gonna tell us where Fu and Willow are right now, or we'll kill you.
Yeah, you got 5 seconds
inside.
Yeah,
what's his name's like? I love to blow your brains out, but and the other guy's like, you got 5 seconds.
And then they bust into the Warriors gym.
They cut to them fighting some more. Fu gets thrown out of the ring. And attacked by like a security guard with a baton, or like a guy in a gi with a baton, but like knocks him out and then gives the baton to Julie Strain. And then she has a baton now, and then a guy with a samurai sword is about to just slash Fu. And that's when they all burst in.
Right.
And they shoot. They shoot the bucket. Like, what's his name?
Oh, God, this was so odd.
I know, yeah. Doc shoots a bucket instead of shooting the bad guy.
And then
slow-mo
shot of Julie Strain. Like,
everybody reacts like
the bucket hitting the wall in slow-mo.
It was weird.
Yeah.
But it was enough to distract Buff.
And then, like,
Buff
the guys
Bagwell
shrugging each other. It's just like, whoops. And then the other guy shoots the guy with the sword.
Buffy shoots the sword guy, and Julie Strain smashes Buff Bagwell's knees apart.
With a rubber thing.
Well, it was supposed to be a police baton, but
it's a rubber police
baton. It's fake, so she could actually hit him with it.
She takes his knees out.
She fucks his knees all up. And then, what does she say to him?
Oh, I need to get something off my chest. That's the third time.
On top of her. Okay.
Because the first time is the woman's, the tiger's like, I need to get something off my chest. What? And she takes her top off.
Yes.
Second time.
She's sitting on.
Second time, Cobra is sitting on Doc in the sauna.
Oh, you're right.
And he's like, I need to get something off my chest.
And this time, Buff Bagwell like pins her basically as he passes out,
and she's like, I need to get something off my chest.
I thought it was three times. Good job, Mike.
Rule of threes. Andy Sidaris is a master of the craft.
He's not a fucking, like I said before, he's incompetent. He's not an idiot.
I feel like also that line is in his other movies too.
I need to get something off my chest.
I think probably. It's like his See You Next Tuesday.
He loves like fucking
let's pop
dad
him off, let's pop one of them in after this.
Yeah, let's just watch all 11 left.
We got through three. We got nine left.
Let's watch them all right now and we'll figure it out.
No.
Anyway, so then the day is saved. Lethal is back on top, right?
Yep, and we get to see them all
We forgot. Did anybody describe who the warrior was?
I mean,
gave like this long backstory about how he used to like work
like
for the government.
CIA. Highly trained.
Then, like after the Cold War ended, they didn't have any use for him, so he became a professional wrestler and traveled the world and making all these connections. And then eventually, he basically was like, I hate America now because I'm worldly and they forgot about me. It was a weird backstory. Sorry.
I mean, the movie's over because
we
go to
a bunch of stuff.
All the hot people, the three couples, which are Widow Black and Jorgensen and Cobra and
Doc,
and then Buff Lee and Tiger. They all show up to a Vegas hotel thing.
Yeah.
To see Fu perform, I guess.
Oh no! It's a riverboat.
It's a riverboat.
The entire thing is filmed in Shreveport, Louisiana.
I don't remember the riverboat. I guess. Yeah, and they all toast to a life of fucking and being weird looking.
They literally reference the sex they're gonna have.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Julie Strain says, and all the great sex.
And all the said great sex.
And then Fu has finally found success as an Elvis impersonator
on the riverboat. Good for him.
And we don't know what happened to Shark and
they're
recovering.
Bullshit line of like
they say they're recovering.
We got news from the LA hospital.
Yeah,
they're recovering.
They're
perfectly.
They're fine. Don't worry about it.
Don't worry about it.
And then it ends. That's it. That's the end of
man.
The warrior feels so insignificant.
Dude, he's barely
in the movie.
It's
like
they do give him a big headdress to wear at one point.
He does also get the he says the titular line. He goes, "This is my day. This is the day of the warrior.
Day of the warrior."
Oh, and his gym has all those weirdly fonted signs in the background.
Oh my god, inappropriately
no pain,
signs.
No gain.
Yeah.
But it's like the words are so tiny.
Yeah.
And
the size of the font's terrible.
It's really bad.
It's like a grandma, like a community center, right. Like printing out like a, you know, put all the Cheetos in the garbage.
Like not only are they too small, they're spaced badly.
Yeah.
Like that's just, it just looks bad. Yeah, this one had, of all those Andy Sidaris movies I've seen, this one had the least amount of gadgets and helicopters and the most amount of fucking and tits. And
yeah.
What about explosions?
And the most explosions.
Yeah,
this
had a lot
like,
of explosions. Because a lot
I'd
of them you're like,
solid
man,
seven
really
or eight.
Happened. This one had a lot of blowing.
Let's see.
Up.
It had a lot of explosions.
There was
man.
The car Jeep at the beginning, then the building. There was the fuel shed.
And
there
the,
was
and
the
car.
Arrow.
And the car. The car.
No,
and,
I said the I said car yeah. shed.
Fuel storage.
Owl.
Kind of counts.
The bow and arrow.
Oh yeah. The boat that exploded.
The boat. There was something else. There was like a house or something that exploded during this movie.
I feel like there was more than six explosions.
Yeah.
That's all I can remember right now though.
This one felt more like a softcore porn than the other ones.
Yeah. There was a lot of sex. Well, there were three couples to fuck. Like, they all had to get their own sex scene. And
like,
even the bad guy got a sex scene for some reason. And you're like, why?
Well, like, Malibu Express feels like a bad action movie. Or a bad, like, Death Wish type bullshit movie. But this felt like softcore porn with action, I guess.
Oh, that was
this
funny.
This is one of his later ones, too.
Yeah,
that's
maybe he just
kind of
gave up. It's like,
well, he knew what he was making money off of. It wasn't
their rallying speech to go save them at the end of the movie is given while they're all like in wearing towels, like they just fresh.
They
just,
oh yeah, they're just like
they
in the sauna.
Freshly
yeah.
had a fuck session.
Yeah, and have showered in
and it seemed like they all did together.
They're like, we got to like clear our heads, guys. We got to really hit a hard reset.
Listen,
and
they could die out
fresh
there,
eyes.
Man. You know.
Andy Sidaris isn't woke enough to have a scene where they're all having sex with each other, like, you know.
Oh, yeah. That'd be great.
Oh, God.
He's like, one man, one woman. That's it.
Boom.
None of this swinging bullshit.
It's wrong.
You fucking kids. You 1996 kids. I don't know. All right. Well.
Yeah, I like this one.
It was fine.
Did you? You screamed a lot at it.
I did.
I
but
still.
It's funny, man. It's like so busted up.
It really
and
is.
Weird, and I like it's Buff Bagwell. I like that Buff
easier
Bagwell
to understand than Picasso Trigger.
Yeah,
but it still doesn't
sad.
Have anything that's a stroke of genius like the Buffingtons from Malibu Express.
Oh,
but then again,
someday well,
not
we got nine more,
anything can compare.
We got
to
nine more of his movies. We might find something.
That,
be
that's what
than
I
the
wanted when Cobra was driving down Beverly Hills. Just the Buffingtons to pull out in front of her. Like,
hey,
yeehaw!
Let's have a race, lady. Didn't I see you stripping? then, right. Like, what? Okay. Yeah, nothing is ever going to come close to that unless something else. And,
yeah.
You know, like even Hard Ticket to Hawaii.
That
with
scene
the,
of
snake.
The fact that two sets of different spies did no spy work.
There's so much
and just
mental work in that. That you know, yes.
Filmed a pornography.
But that all seems just like a mistake of bad filmmaking and writing.
Yeah, I know.
Whereas the Buffingtons is like. Intentionally interrupting
know,
a movie.
I know.
Like the owl was the Buffingtons of this movie.
I just love that if you, out of context, showed someone that scene and you were
they'd
like,
be like, oh, porn.
What happened there?
People, pornographers film pornography.
Some people figured out how to break
and then
the
they all went home. Goodbye. good, another day's work.
How many
can?
Of those people were spies? Raise your hand. Like, what? Like, how many people think any
the
spies
only way
were
you,
in
no,
the room?
The only shot. Anyone? The only shot you'd know something was up from, you know, out of context is the shot
the
of
lens.
The camera filming
yeah.
the
yeah.
other thing. Other than that, it's just a scene of people filming porn.
How much
so
porn
good.
Do you think
they
you,
said
you've
were
watched
thousands.
Where they were everyone was secretly a spy?
Dude, now I'm going to question mean, every time I ever look at
that's
porn.
It.
For
yeah,
the rest
I'm
going to
assume everyone's
like,
a spy.
How many these people are
spies? Barely doing their job. Like, oh, if that guy was a spy, he could totally kill these people. They're totally distracted. Slice their necks up, man. This is real. King and country. God damn it.
Oh, man.
Okay. Good. Thank you, Mike. Yeah, for
thank you for having me.
We'll another nail in this coffin of Sidaris movies.
We'll see everybody in 10 years when we finish this 12-pack.
Yep.
We got through three in, like, two.
Yeah. Right.
We're doing great.
I'm trying to keep it spaced out because I know when if I ask Mike to be on, we're doing one of these fucking movies.
Well, his time away from his family is precious, as I learned earlier.
Yes.
For being scolded for talking
I
about
love
meat.
Too, that
you talked about meat for half an hour.
I love that you take that you basically are the one who bought these movies, so you're basically taking your time out to watch titty movies.
It's like, sorry, dear, I need to go to Bob's so I can hang out and watch titty movies and then talk about them. So that the amount of time I'd be away is actually now double or triple even, because we need to analyze the titty movies.
Yeah, we need to break it down as though the plot had validity and meaning.
Instead of you just watching it at home. It's a good move.
It's good, you know? And
Andy Sidaris would appreciate it.
Yeah.
He's a master of the craft. Auteur, filmmaker.
He wasn't a family man, and that's okay.
He was married.
I know, he was married. I wonder what his wife looks like. It had to be somebody from one of his movies, right?
I saw her profile in one of the last time we did this, I looked up the Facebook, like a Facebook profile for it. And someone made an Andy Sidaris like Facebook group that's not actually related to him. And so a bunch of people that were in the Andy Sidaris movies were like commenting on it. It's like, who is this? And like his his wife was just like, who are you? You're not Andy Sidaris. And how do I get rid of this? And oh god, give me like 30 seconds I can
that's
find
insane.
It.
Are you seriously gonna look at
it? Dude, I had it up earlier, so
wait, what's the group called?
It's called Andy Sidaris Public Figure. It hasn't posted anything since 2014.
When did he die?
I think it was mid-aughts.
That makes sense.
Okay, here it is. So there's one post that says, babes always have a purse less than the needed ones, with 3 likes. But then there are 7 comments.
Say that again? Okay. What?
Yeah, a lot of these posts are like this. Like, one just says bullets, bombs, and brandy. And then the one after that says, babes always have a purse less than the needed ones. But then... First comment, Arlene Sidaris. I don't know what this post means, and Andy didn't write it. James Abilene, who is in the movies. It's obvious a fan page using Andy's name, but they seem unresponsive to your comments. I say report them. Arlene, do you know the steps to report? I don't.
Oh my God.
James. Arlene. Yes. Follow the pictures I put up. So here's a screen cap of how to report.
God damn it.
James, now choose it's a scam. And he circles the little it's a scam button. James, now choose this page has copied information about my business in another screen cap. James, now choose mark as a scam. I marked it as a scam too from the this page is fake tab. So.
That's his wife.
Yeah.
Todd had to blog a page, that's his, page by an
it's
actor.
His fucking legacy right there.
Yep.
The two of them also were looking at the page.
Oh my God.
You know what I mean? Like,
beautiful.
The two of them went on Facebook and were like, I wonder what the online community says about my husband. Or
dude, people who don't do shit Google their own name.
I know.
You know, people who actually do shit probably Google stuff. Well, I don't know why. Well, I don't know.
My friend's ghost hunting, failed ghost hunting business has a page, and the only thing on it is somebody yelling at them for shutting down their hotel for a night and then never seeing anybody.
Oh my God. You know what? His like ability to convey like a story about espionage is like on par with like Neil Breen.
Yeah.
But he just like made better movies, which is like weird.
Andy Sidaris is a markedly better filmmaker. Like,
but he has all the same beats though. It's all this weird conspiracy spy things. There's inappropriate like sexualization of people.
It's better.
It's much better.
Like,
it's like
I don't even mean
that's what I'm saying. Like,
Like, it's edited better, it's shot better, and it's not shot well. It's just better than Neil Breen. It's like Neil Breen's really bad.
Yeah,
it's interesting. Yeah. They're kind of, they're pretty similar, but he's better. He's like his movies are better.
Suck but the Neil difference Breen. Is that I don't think
Neil Breen's trying to say something.
Neil Breen's trying to say something. It's an act of ego, and he's starring in them because of such.
Yeah.
Whereas Andy Sidaris, I think, genuinely likes schlock. Action and spy movies with boobs,
titties. Yeah,
I don't think there was any like grand illusions of grandeur or anything.
Yeah,
like Andy Sidaris. Mm-hmm. Whereas Neil Breen thinks he's doing something.
Neil Breen thinks he's Jesus come to earth,
pretty much. Or
Well, I mean, he made a whole movie where he was.
So. Yeah,
he did make a movie like that. But I don't think Andy Sidaris thinks anything highly of himself.
Yeah,
which is why these kind of are endearing as long as you keep them within their context of history.
Yes.
You know, they're misogynistic trash.
Oh God, yeah. But it's like, you know, he doesn't put any pretense about what these movies are. It's like, listen, you're going to see some very large tits very often. You're going to see some slabs of man meat, and then we're going to blow some stuff up.
He's like the girls going wild guy making movies.
Yeah.
Like, that's
hopefully
what he is.
Less exploitative.
Yeah. Like, I don't feel like he was ever trying to say anything about the world or anything.
No.
Like, there's no message.
No, because I mean,
the
these plots are like insane. They're just like generic spy things.
Yeah.
It's like insanely generic.
Like, here's
like,
the formula
guy
for these
he stole
spies.
Art and gold and diamonds. Well, from all over the world.
He has a whole series for it's the Lethal Lady series. And you know, the formula is we're going to have two or three pairs of spy couples so we can see them fucking. And that's why they get it complicated, because he needs to have those three pairs.
He needs to have a lot of characters to have sex.
Yeah. And
because
then,
if there's too few characters, you have to actually write dialogue.
Yeah.
And plot.
Yeah.
Well, it's easier to write introductory dialogue.
You just keep introducing people until they start solving their problems, and then the movie's over.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's kind of how it works.
Yeah.
They introduced Jordanson like 45 minutes into the fucking movie.
Like, that's exactly the difference,
fucks.
Too.
And then he had sex, and you're like, I didn't think that guy was even going to matter.
Yeah. There you go. And then there's his weird accent again. Okay.
It's like, weird, it's, man. There's an equivalent of like having red shirts on Star Trek. You know, you need people to die on screen to show how dangerous something is.
He just needs people,
to fuck on screen. He needs more characters. So, like, yes, you could write this plot with literally two spies.
Yeah.
And like a head guy. Or, you know, it could be Julie Strain and two spies that fuck, but he wants more fucking, so you gotta make it all mess. You know? I mean, he probably made a lot of money with
some of these.
So he's not like a complete, like you said, he's not an idiot.
No, he's just
he's not an idiot. It's just I don't think there's a lot of care that goes into him.
Yeah, he doesn't care about writing a script that makes any sense.
Any sense.
Or he just does not understand espionage.
Also, they're probably made under extreme duress.
Or just storytelling.
I'm wondering how the writing is in his book now.
Dude, Mike, you're going to get that
Mike,
book.
Mike, you want to buy
the signed
book so
copy.
Bad.
Buy
that
get
book.
The signed copy. Doesn't make any sense.
Hey, honey, you know that thing that I wasted time not with my family on? I bought a book about it.
To bring to you and be in the house with our family.
It's signed by a softcore. I'm just gonna put
Happy
it in visible sight of our entire family on Christmas. So
you know, it was just our anniversary. I couldn't, you know, get that as a late present. Or I could just save it till Christmas, and you know, at the family unwrapping, just be like, "Look what I got you!
Boobs, blood, and babes."
It's like the Homer getting Marge a bowling ball. Bombs.
See?
You love
it.
If you don't like it, I'll use it. God damn it. All right. Well, hopefully the next time Mike is on, he'll have a book.
Some choice excerpts.
You don't have to buy the book, Mike. You've already bought a 12-pack of DVDs.
I already bought something really stupid this past week, so let my stupid budget just sort of accrue again.
We'll remind you of the book.
Yeah.
What was your stupid purchase?
I bought Love on a Leash on DVD so I could see if it has the soundtrack.
Did it? You are sick.
It hasn't gotten here yet.
Oh.
You're sick, man.
I am. Not going to deny that. I just need to know if it has the soundtrack.
One day we might do Love on a Leash on bonus disc, but after Bonnie does it. All right. That's it. Thank you, Mike.
Goodbye.
Thank you, guys.
You've just listened to Bonus Disc, available only on Thundergrunt. Questions, complaints, and movie suggestions can be posted to facebook.com/bonusdisc. Opinions and criticisms of the hosts of Bonus Disc are 100% valid, even though they took the time to watch the movies you were too ignorant to appreciate.